And influence in our life. And our goal is to make the hard part just a little bit easier, so the good part is just a little bit better. Big gatherings of family and friends are difficult in the times that we're living in, but I'm glad that you were here. And we have gatherings like this usually for only a couple of reasons. One, there's a good reason to get together. Number two, you like and love somebody so much you just want to hang out with them. And today, it's because Bob was loved. And he is a very good reason for us to join ourselves together. Our attendance at this service is a public display of affection for Bob and how he touched his family and how he touched his players and how he touched his friends. The time and effort that you've displayed by making an effort to be here in less than ideal circumstances is an indication that you want to honor his life, you want to contribute to his legacy, and you're in need of comfort, support, and encouragement. And you're also willing to share that same comfort, support, and encouragement with his family. So thank you so very, very much. There's a lot of you that I don't know, and you have no idea who I am, and I can just tell you this, I'm nobody. My connection to this family started with that guy right there, with Bob's grandson, Jordan. I saw they had him listed as doctor in the obituary. I don't know if I could call you a doctor or not, but anyway, I'm grateful not only that you are my son's best friend, but I'm grateful that because of you, I had the privilege of getting to know Bob Bennett. I have never felt more inadequate for a task than I do today. I sort of feel like it's the bottom of the ninth inning of a national championship game and the bases are loaded and they're two out and we're three runs down and I'm the last guy on the bench. And I've only been to bat two times the entire season, and both times I was asked to sacrifice bunt. I found myself at 4:30 this morning, staring in the mirror as I put in every article of my clothing, because I know Bob was somewhat of a stickler of the way you wore your uniform. And I stood there in the mirror watching as I buckled on my belt and I put on my shirt, because I felt like Bob was watching, and I didn't want to be inadequately dressed today. Everyone at a time like this needs to be honored. But few in my lifetime have lived a life with such magnitude of honor as Bobby Jean Bennett did. I really don't feel deserving of this exceedingly incredible honor. And the privilege I have of standing here today to recognize a man who lived a quality of life and a quantity of life. Bob was a man of breadth and depth. He lived long. He lived well. Bob was multidimensional. It would have been so easy just to have made this a baseball service. We could have played Take Me Out to the Ball Game, but you know what? That would not have fit who Bob was. Bob was far more than just baseball. And the thing is, to be so multidimensional, he excelled in every dimension. He wasn't just sort of good in some areas and really good in one area. He was really good in every area that I knew him to be. Coach was not just great on the field. He excelled as a husband. He had a wonderful wife, Jane, who took incredibly good care of him. He excelled as a father. The things I've heard from all three of his kids, consistent, every single one of them. A grandfather, in the classroom as a teacher, put a pen in his hand and he would hit a home run on a sheet of paper. That was Bob Bennett. So I listened to all the stories and read all the articles I could find and listened to the interviews that Mr. Loeffler did last week. Four words kept jumping into my mind that kind of capture the essence of Bob Bennett: family, friends, fundamentals, and faith. So if there is going to be a win today, It's going to be a team effort. Jack Hanna told me this week that Coach Bennett said, there's no I in team, but there is an I in win. And that means every member of the team has to do their part if the team is going to win. And so with the help of family members and friends, we're going to do this together. At the beginning of every game, fans would stand for the national anthem. Today, at the beginning of this tribute, I'm going to ask you to stand as we pray. Would you stand, please? Our Father in heaven, I am so grateful that you have blessed this world with people, men like Bob Bennett, men who young boys could look up to and learn from, could idolize and want to emulate, a man that recognizes the value of family, a man that recognizes the value of hard work, a man that recognizes the value of faith. It is a legacy worth talking about, and it is a life worth duplicating. He has infused his wisdom and his knowledge and his example into the life of every member of his family. And Father, it'll be exciting to see what you do in and through their lives in the days and the years to come. Father, I pray for your care and your comfort to be available to us today, and that we can leave here just a little bit better than the way in which we arrived, and our lives will be enriched because we have learned something about Bob Bennett that will forever change our lives. So we trust you for all this and so much more. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. You may be seated as Bob Berthold sings for us, "You Raise Me Up."
When I am down and oh, my soul so weary, when shadows come and my heart burden be, then I am still and wait here in the silence until you come and sit a while with me. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. And I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be. Stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be. You raise me up to more than I can be.
A man approached a Little League baseball game one afternoon, and he asked the boy in the dugout what the score was. The boy responded, 18 to nothing. We're behind. Boy, said the spectator, I'll bet you're discouraged. The little boy said, discouraged? Why? We haven't even got up to bat yet. That sort of reflects, I think, Bob Bennett's attitude, whether he was facing a number one team in the country or whether he was battling Parkinson's. I think Bob always had a sense, give me a chance to get up to bat, and we can do something with this life. We have a story to tell today, and it's Bob's story, and maybe as a result of the influence of Bob, we might decide to write a new chapter in our own. And our perspective of life, our perspective of death, our perspective of what's on the other side of death will determine how we might write this next chapter. I can't make you believe anything about life after death. I can simply tell you if I didn't believe that was there, I wouldn't be here today, because this would be a very miserable place to be. If this is all there is, if this is the conclusion to Bob Bennett's life, I would be so depressed I would want to be anywhere else but here. But I have great hope. I have great hope there is something beyond this world, something better than a COVID-19 society. And I believe Bob had that same kind of faith. And so let's look at his life. He was born 86 years ago in Atwood, Oklahoma. I looked Atwood up on Wikipedia. 2010 census, 92 people lived there, all right? You can't find a town, but there still was a post office in 2010. It could be closed down now, but 92 people lived there in 2010. The irony of this is all of my family came from Oklahoma as well, and he was born less than 40 miles from where my mother and my grandmother were born. So who knows, their lives may have crossed at some point in time before they ever ended up in California. He was born on June the 22nd, 1933. Do any of you know what day of the week Bob was born on? We know it was the 22nd, but was it Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday? Don't feel bad. I've asked this question hundreds of times over the last 15 years. Nobody has ever known. You'll know now. Bob was born on a Thursday, all right? He was going to be ready for a game on Friday, all right? Franklin Delano Roosevelt was president at that time in the United States, and there were talking movies in the theater at his birth, so he's not that old, all right? The hit movies that year, you'll recognize one or two of them. King Kong, with Faye Ray, all right? That was out that year. James Cagney had two called Picture Snatcher and Lady Killer, and Katharine Hepburn was in that classic Little Women. Hit songs? You might not recognize, at least those of you on this side, all right? Those of you a few rows back. Ethel Waters, do you remember her? Great, great voice. She had a song out called Stormy Weather, and Bing Crosby, Shadow Waltz. Those were number one and number two that year. Jane, your husband shared a birthday with some pretty famous and infamous people. Born on June 22nd, different year, but June 22nd, John Dillinger. Any of you all know what he's known for? Yeah, bank robberies, all right? Bank robberies. He was born in 03. This one's fascinating. Carl Hubble. Any of you recognize that name? You're going to be a baseball player, all right? Yeah, Carl Hubble was a two-time MVP pitcher in the National League. He's best remembered for his performance in the 1934 All-Star Game when he struck out five future Hall of Famers in a row. Babe Ruth, Lou Gehrig, Jimmy Fox, Al Simmons, Joe Cronin, all in a row at an All-Star Game. Hubble's primary pitch, screwball. Okay. He also shared the same birthday with Cornelius Dutch Warmonden. Did you all know that? Because they coached together at Fresno State. They shared the same birthday. Dutch was a little bit older. For those of you who don't know, you don't recognize that name. He was a coach. He graduated from Hanford, and he was also a coach at Fresno State in track. And he held the world record in pole vault from 1940 to 1957. He missed the Olympics because of the war, but he did hold the world record that long. And then there was Pistol Pete Maravich, a basketball player who shared that very same birthday. I don't know what your political persuasions are, but he also shared that birthday with a relatively well-known California politician, Dianne Feinstein, the very same year. His parents were James Arthur and Ella May, and he shared his parents with one sister, Betty Zimmerman, and Betty is sitting right here in front of me with a great big smile on her face. The Bennett family were victims of the Dust Bowl, and they became migrant farm workers, moving between Oklahoma and California. Bob's work life began at age 5, picking cotton. My grandmother, Roland, picked cotton, and she thought when I was about 7, I ought to have that experience. It lasted about 5 minutes, all right, and we were done picking cotton. That was really hard work. Growing up in poverty and learning the value and the necessity of hard work forged a man who later found great success in his chosen field of coaching and teaching. Bob's family moved to Fresno in the early 40s. He attended Longfellow Junior High and Roosevelt High School, where he excelled not only in the classroom but also on the baseball field under the tutelage of Coach Ollie Bidwell. He graduated in 1951. Right out of high school, he went to Fresno State. He started at catcher all 4 years at Fresno State, playing for Coach Pete Biden. I've noticed something through the years. If you want to be a good coach in the Fresno area, your last name better begin with B. Okay? So you had Bidwell and Biden and Bennett. All right? It just sort of seems to run that direction. Jack Hanna was playing at Fresno State at the same time that Bob was. I talked with Jack yesterday, and Jack sends his deepest apologies that he could not be here. Literally was crying on the phone with me today. I don't know that I've ever seen Jack cry, but he was crying this morning. He has surgery tomorrow. He met with the doctor for his pre-op yesterday and went home with signed instructions that he had signed saying, I won't go out in public. And so he was not able to be here today, but he's going to get to watch. I told him he could watch it on Facebook, and he said, what's that? And so we're going to take it over to him in a couple of days and let him have the opportunity of watching this service. But Jack told me that every time the two of them would get together, it seems like that Bob always loved to share one of his fondest memories of being Jack's catcher. They were playing USC. USC was ranked number 1 in the nation, and this was the play-in game to go to the Nationals championship. And Jack, under the leadership of Bob calling all the pitches, Jack struck out 15 players that day, and Fresno State beat USC. And they love telling that story. Bob learned from Coach Bidwell and Coach Biden the importance of fundamentals, how to use coaching baseball to not just teach baseball, but also to teach character and values. Bob graduated in 1955, and about a month after he received his college degree, he purchased a marriage license. Bob had been introduced to Sarah Jane Bush by some mutual friends, the Petersons. And what a wonderful introduction that turned out to be, wasn't it, Jane? So, in Monterey, California, on July 15th, 1955, we're just a month away from that, Bob and Jane would have celebrated their 65th anniversary. That day in July, Bob and Jane became Mr. and Mrs. Bennett. For almost 65 years, they walked hand in hand and heart in heart through life. Let me read how Bob felt about that marriage. It's recorded in one of his books called Roots and Wings. And one of his poems is entitled Wedding Anniversary. A wedding anniversary is a statement clear, love and commitment, two people hold dear. The anniversary indicates another year passed that a beautiful love did last and last. The first is special and it draws applause, but as they grow, we see the cause. Commitments made, commitments honored and kept, at truth and loyalty, this couple is adept. As the years go by, this day should say, I love you more in every way. Jane, no wonder you married this man, all right? Had such a golden tongue. Their marriage was blessed with three children, Karen, Prieto, and Bob. The oldest was the daughter, also the best. Sorry, boys, I got to play up to her, all right? Because I never want to be on Karen's bad side, all right? I like being on her good side. They live in Clovis Academy, all right? Brad and Boogie, they live in Tokyo. We hope Brad gets to go back home one of these days. Right now, he can't. Todd and Kim now live in Fairfield. Eight grandchildren, Jeff and Jamie Prieto, Jordan and Kristen Prieto, Brett and Karen Prieto. Brett, at least she spells her name differently than your mother, all right? Corinne, I'm sorry, Corinne. Okay, that's good, because that would be horrible. Yeah, that. All right, so Corinne. No, I like to say it right, so thank you. Brandon and Corrine, did I get that one right? Corinne, both of them are both Corinnes? Holy mackerel. Now I'm even afraid to say anybody else's name in his family, because none of them know how to spell. All right, not a one of them know how to spell. Natalie and Royce Keene, did I get that one right? Good, all right. Hannah and Shane, all right. Good to see you, buddy. Overton and Catherine Bennett and Mark Bennett. 13 great-grandchildren. Wyatt, Avery, Morgan, Betty, Beau, Piper, JoJo, Noah, Rory, Rhett, Reese, Rourke, McCaffrey. Got through all the great-grandkids just right. All right, good. Bob and Jane lived in Keensburg from 1957 to 1959 and then lived in Fresno for the next 43 years before moving to Clovis in 2002. After his playing career at Fresno State, Bob was drafted by the Detroit Tigers, but he opted for a career in coaching and teaching. Bob's first coaching job was at Keensburg High for 2 years, and then he spent a little over a decade at Bullard High School. While at Bullard, Bob taught PE, business classes, and driver's education. He truly loved his students and his players. Bob had an amazing memory for students. He remembered their name, and he remembered the special place they had in his life. When Pete Biden took a sabbatical year from Fresno State, Bob served as the interim coach. That was in 1967. And then he was hired as head coach in 1969. Bob retired in 2002 after 32 one-year contracts. That is a record, I am confident. How many of you are in the room and you played baseball for Bob Bennett? Would you stand? No, please stand. If you played the game for Bob Bennett, I want you to stand. All right. Turn around, just take a look so you can see each other. All right. What an alumni team this would be. All right. Grab a bat and a glove. Let's go play ball. Thank you all for being here today. He coached 2,065 college games, and his record would be 1,302 wins, 759 losses, and 4 ties. When he retired, he was 7th in the NCAA Division I history in career victories. He had 26 consecutive winning seasons and only had 2 losing seasons in his entire career. He won 14 Conference Coach of the Year honors and was named NCAA Coach of the Year in 1988 by the Sporting News. Bennett's coach for Team USA in 1977 and 1979, and he managed the team in 1983 International Cup when they won a silver medal, and 1986 the Amateur World Series. Bennett took Fresno State to the 1988 and 1991 College World Series. He helped to develop a lot of players who went on to play professional baseball. I even hate to mention the names because I might miss some of you, but he had a huge impact. His number 26 was the first number ever retired by Fresno State. He was once president of the American Baseball Coaches Association, inducted in the Fresno County Athletic Hall of Fame in 1990, the ABCA Hall of Fame, the College Baseball Hall of Fame in 2010. In total, he is a member of 7 Hall of Fames. In 2016, he was honored by Fresno State when the stadium was dedicated in his honor, renaming it Pete Biden Field at Bob Bennett Stadium. So very, very appropriate. Bob was especially proud of the fact that the opportunity to coach his 2 sons and his son-in-law and 2 of his grandsons at Fresno State. He was dedicated to athletics in the Central Valley, hosting numerous clinics and summer camps, teaching thousands of kids the fundamentals of baseball, also working to develop several coaches throughout the area and around the world. After retiring from Fresno State, he continued to follow his passion for teaching and coaching, giving private lessons and working with high school teams. And he would even find time to squeeze in impromptu lessons for friends of his grandsons. And this is a dad who was so grateful. After retiring, he continued to follow that passion for teaching and coaching. He would give private lessons. He would work with high school teams, Fresno Christian, Clovis East, Sunnyside, Central High, and Clovis North. His hobbies, a host of hobbies, woodworking, loving on his family, collecting. And he went through phases of what he collected, things like knives, pens, gloves, all right? He enjoyed tinkering. He loved writing, and he was good at it. An accomplished writer and poet. He wrote several books and produced instructional videos on catching, pitching, infield play, and hitting. He wrote hundreds of poems, which are published in 5 different books. He enjoyed traveling to go see family, and with family, he loved going to Avila Beach. When I asked what were his favorite foods, I probably could have guessed. Cornbread and milk. And for those of you who don't know, you put the cornbread in the milk. All right, that's the way a good Okie eats it. It's okay to call Okies Okies. It's perfectly fine. What you do not call them is ditch bake Okies. Okay, that you've crossed the line. He also loved chicken fried steak. He enjoyed a good watermelon, grapes, peaches, lots of fruit. He wanted his coffee, and he enjoyed a nice bag of popcorn. His favorite dessert, according to the boys, was ice cream. Preferred flavor, Rocky Road. When I ask about favorite restaurants, do you know what I was told, Jane? Your cooking. He preferred to eat at home. He enjoyed interesting things on TV. Larry's Country Diner. Country family reunions. Finding out all the backstories to the country music stars. And a program called Pickers. He also enjoyed Gunsmoke. If you are missing an episode of Gunsmoke, Bob Bennett has it taped. He has 86 episodes taped. Baseball was his favorite sport, but he did not root for a favorite team unless one of his family members were playing on it. He just enjoyed a good game. Bob spoke here at New Hope Church on, I believe, 2 different occasions. He spoke to our men's breakfast. We hold a Saturday morning men's breakfast once a month, and Bob was so kind to come on 2 different occasions, and I could tell you that he probably was one of our favorite guests. And one of the reasons is Bob was never in a hurry to leave, and Bob never minded questions. He loved fielding questions. He would share stories about baseball. He would share stories about family. He would share stories about your word is important. Honesty was important. Integrity was important. Faith was important. I heard through the grapevine that Bob had been a participant for 3 years or more in a most unique Bible study. It didn't meet weekly. It met monthly over the last 3 or 4 years. And it wasn't for an hour. It was for an entire day. This Bible study had 2 different names, depending on whether 5 guys showed up or 6 guys showed up. If 5 showed up, the Bible study was called the Fumbling 5. If 6 guys showed up, they were called the Sorry 6. Here's who they are. If you're here today and you're part of that Bible study, I'd like you to stand for just a moment when I call your name, if you would, please. Jack Hanna, who's the one who gave me all this information, so if it's wrong, all right, blame Jack. He's not here today. All right. Bob Bennett. Bob is with us here today. Tom Summers. I know Tom is here. Fred Frazier. Fred's sitting right over there. All right. Bob Talmadge, not able to be with us today. And what would go from 5 to 6 was Billy Bartell. And he, I understand, lives in Kentucky. Is that correct? Connecticut. All right. In Connecticut. Sometimes he could fly in and make it, and sometimes he couldn't. And they would meet for an entire day every month for 3 to 4 years. And Jack Hanna said, Tim, I know that Bob had faith for a long time, but I can tell you an exact day when Bob Bennett made sure that he knew that Christ lived in his heart because I was in the room with him in Tom Summers' office. And so that's good news for all of us today. What words describe Bob Bennett? Here's some that his family had to say. Consistent, caring, tenacious, dedicated, honorable, grounded, focused, interested in others, loving, passionate, a problem solver, grateful, a good listener, blessed, humble. That might be the one for me. A man that I've just described never walked with airs, never walked with a false sense of pride. Oh, he walked confident, but always humble. Here's an example. It was important to Coach Bennett that each of his players know that he loved them individually, that he was proud of them individually and collectively as a team. And he one time said, "I'd like to think that I touched some lives along the way, but here's what I know. So many other lives have touched mine." You don't get more humble than that. He was interested in others more than himself. His faith was solid. His wit was quick and funny. He was honest. He was loyal. He had unconditional love. He was a great role model. He was steady, courageous. 20 years he fought Parkinson's with great courage. Jack Hanna gave a quote yesterday on the phone. He said he's the best pitching coach in college baseball. Anybody want to argue with Jack? You're going to hear some other perspectives and reflections today of Bob Bennett, and they're going to come from members of his family. And to lead the parade of family members is going to be Todd. Guys, we're about in the fourth inning of this nine-inning game. All right? Todd, come on up.
Thank you, Tim.
You bet, buddy.
Tim, your uniform looks good, but we were scheduled to start at 10. We started at 10:05. So at least 1 6-minute mile before you can come up on stage again. I'm going to make all of us run a 6-minute mile. I'm also really glad, Tim, that you tell that story about Carl Hubbell, because up until then, the thing that Brad and I knew him most for was one day when we were about 8 or 9 years old, we were standing around him trying to get his autograph, and another little kid walked up with the program and said, "Mr. Hubbell, can I have your autograph?" And Carl looked at him and said, "You have a pen?" And the kid said no, and he took the program and threw it over his shoulder and said, "Next." Carl could be that way. Yeah, a little bit. Well, thank you all very much for coming today. I wish we could have had everybody that wanted to be here. As I considered and prayed about this and what I'd say, you know, there's so many things that ran through my mind. And as Tim said, Dad lived almost 87 years. So I thought, you know, that maybe a 30 or 40 minute just kind of extemporaneous rambling would be, no? All right. So I separated my thoughts down, and I put them in three categories that I think everybody who knew my dad would understand. They talk about his life and his contributions. One is baseball. Two is the power of positive thinking. And then three, Tim talked about character and values of family. So baseball was one of his many passions, and it was the key to various passions that he had, because baseball teaches us so many lessons about life. Whether you're setting hitting or pitching or catching, infield play, outfield play, or base running, it all starts with balance and strong foundation built on proven solid fundamentals, and such is life. Baseball teaches us that you're going to fail a lot more often than you're going to succeed. And it teaches you that you're going to lose from time to time and that you're going to make errors. It also teaches you that if you work hard and stay focused, even the weakest team in the league can beat the strongest team on any given day. And even when you're down several runs in the bottom of the ninth with two outs and you have an 0-2 count, a rally and a victory are still in reach. His interest in this game took him from a life of poverty and took him all over the world and brought him a lot of great success at what he did. His mom and dad and Aunt Betty moved between California and Oklahoma, working as migrant farm workers, and learning the value of hard work, as Tim said, and my dad knew that he wanted to work hard, but he didn't want to pick fruit or cotton his whole life. So he started out then after working as a cotton picker and working in the fields, he started as a paper boy, and he had two different routes. And he'd ride his bike from where they lived in downtown Fresno all the way out to Camp Pinedale to deliver papers and back. That was just one of his routes. So he always worked hard, and then when he was in college, he had a job at McMahon's Furniture, delivering furniture, and his dad, my grandpa, didn't know why he was still going to college, because he had a good job, and he said he shouldn't bother going to college, you already have a good job, and dad was just sure, you know, he wanted to be a teacher and a coach, and so he was going to get his degree, and then when he got his first paycheck at Kingsburg High, it was less than what he was making delivering furniture at McMahon's, but he stuck with it, and thankfully it turned out okay for him. He was able to turn this passion for baseball and into a vehicle to show others how to succeed in life, and that's just what baseball was. It was a passion, it was a vehicle to teach others character and importance, the importance of details and balance, and how to succeed in life and follow their passions. The next thing that I brought up, this prop, I found this in his bookshelf, and this book changed his life and so many others. And this is his copy of it, the original one. This is The Power of Positive Thinking by the Reverend Norman Vincent Peale. And there's so many things in that book. There's 17 chapters in the book, and anytime any of us, either one of his kids or one of his grandkids or one of his players was suffering with, you know, things that were really bothering him in life and having issues, he'd always suggest read this book because it changed his life. And the 17 chapters, when you break them down, are really, really interesting. I skipped ahead. I want to go back to baseball because I have a Bible quote from Colossians 3:23. It says, "Whatever you do, work heartily as for the Lord and not for men." And that's what my dad did. And that's how he faced the responsibility of coaching and teaching. In my dad's words, because he did all these quotes too, just one-liners. He said, "When commitment and preparation fill your chest, then you may say you did your best." And he said, "A good coach understands the learning process and uses his knowledge and perceptions to make sure the players have been provided the proper information and understanding to compete." So back to the power of positive thinking. You know, my dad faced a lot of adversity in his life. He was born into poverty at a time when there was no government assistance, no social programs, no handouts. There were people that were helping a lot. My grandfather was an alcoholic and had a hard time holding a job. And he was this poor kid from Oklahoma living in California. He did face discrimination and unfair judgment growing up. And then during his time at Fresno State, especially the last few years, despite having great success and continuing that success on the field, establishing the dugout club, leading and organizing the fundraising and building of the stadium at Biden Field, he was harassed and vilified by administrators and members in the press, and that was hard on him. And then just before he retired, he got hit with Parkinson's disease. And all the various health issues that come along with that. But he faced each of these challenges with a positive attitude and the belief that he would persevere. His faith in Jesus Christ and this book anchored him. 17 chapters in The Power of Positive Thinking provided a blueprint for a well-lived, successful, happy life and how to contribute to the positive energy that lifts others up and helps them succeed and be happy. So, just some of the chapters are: believe in yourself, a peaceful mind generates power, and how to create constant energy. And some Bible verses that go along with that are Romans 8:31, if God is against us, who can be? Or if God is with us, who can be against us? And then one of my favorites that really talks about my dad, I think, is Isaiah 40:29-31. He gives power to the faint, and to him who has no might, he increases strength. Even youths shall faint and be weary, and young men shall be exhausted. But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up on the wings of eagles. They shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and not faint. And if you ever played racquetball against him or tried to compete with him in a distance running event or tried to cut wood with him or do any physical labor, I don't care. If Brad and I were at our prime, we'd be 18 to 22 years old, and he would kick our butts at all those things. And never seemed like he got tired either. Also in the book, create your own happiness. Stop fuming and fretting. Expect the best and get it. And don't believe in defeat. Mark 9:23 says, everything is possible for those who believe. And talking about not believing in defeat, I never stepped onto a baseball field ever and didn't just know we were going to win the game. And it didn't matter who we were playing. It didn't matter what, you know, didn't matter. We were going to win. And that was my dad's belief too. And that was the way he faced everything. You know, whatever the issue was, no matter how big it was, building the stadium, millions of people, not millions, thousands told him he couldn't do that. Wasn't going to happen. He did it. You know, just every time that you compete. And one of the things that he said that I wrote down here is, this is one of my dad's quotes, don't enter the race unless you plan to win. Commitment to win is important, but equally important is to refuse to lose. Then the book also talks about try the power of prayer and draw on a higher power. And in Mark chapter 11, verse 24, it says, therefore I tell you, whatever you ask in prayer, believe that you have received it and it will be yours. And my dad believed that and walked that his entire life. The final little area I want to talk about is character and family values. And though, even though he achieved great success in coaching, it wasn't the winning record, the championships, the halls of fame, the stadium, or even the respect that he got from his colleagues that were his greatest success. He would tell you that his family, his marriage to my mom of 65 years, his kids, his grandkids, great-grandkids, and the relationships that he had with his players and his friends were his most valued accomplishments. He never backed down. He was always supporting and fighting for what he knew was right. And he knew that everybody, regardless of their background, was capable of holding themselves to high standards and choosing to do the right thing. My dad was deeply appreciative of some mentors in his life that lent him guidance and encouragement and a helping hand. They were guys in the Fresno area back then in the 40s and 50s named Damon Bailey, former Mayor Ted C. Wills Sr., Ollie Bidwell, Walt Byrd Sr. All these guys were really instrumental in his life and provided him guidance in a fatherly-like way, and he was committed to doing that for others throughout his life. As a dad, he was the best. He was consistent and caring, and he had that knack of knowing when to listen and when to advise. And sometimes that was a little frustrating because I wanted advice, but he knew I'd come to it on my own if I just got it out and talked about it. He was especially proud of the fact that Bobby and Brad and Jeff and Jordan and I were able to play for him at Fresno State. And all of the brothers, Bobby's brother Larry played there too, the Garcia brothers, there's a ton of brothers that went through there. And that always made him happy that, you know, a family valued the program so much that they sent more than one kid to him. Now you might think that since Brad and I played baseball, he kind of pushed it on us and made us play, and that nothing could be further from the truth. He was coaching baseball all the time, so when he finally got a day off, he didn't really want to go out there with us. And so we would beg him and beg him and beg him to go out, take us out hitting, Dad. And then when he finally did, we'd go out with a bag of balls. One of us would be in the outfield shagging. The other one would be hitting. And after one guy was done hitting, we had to gather all the balls, count them all to make sure none were missing. And then the other guy would hit. We'd go back and forth like that for a while. And then when we were done, he would subject us to a little fungo work. Now, Brad throws left-handed, I throw right-handed, but we both had to be at shortstop taking ground balls for a long time. In the summer, no water. And then when we were done with that, we'd get out in the outfield. And I'm the slowest runner that God ever created. But it didn't matter. I was never going to play the outfield, but we would take fly balls. And my dad had that talent with a fungo bat where he could put the ball wherever he wanted to. And he also knew exactly what 100% of your effort was. And he knew that if I ran 100%, where to put that ball where I could still get it. But if I loafed just a little bit, I wasn't going to catch the ball. It was going to get past me, and then I'd have to sprint all the way to the fence to get it so that I could get back in place in time for him to hit it again. He worked as hard, didn't he, Brad? But it was a lot of fun, and we loved it. And the reason Brad and I were out there is because we loved baseball as much as my dad did. At home, he was one of the funniest people ever. He was always whistling and singing in a faux operatic voice. I know Karen and my mom didn't really appreciate that too much, especially the whistling. And he was always making funny comments about current events on the news or people and telling funny stories. Two of the greatest treasures that we have, he and I, when I was about 11 or 12, we did these three improv tapes where I was the interviewer and I would make up a character for him to be, and he'd take on that character and do a whole interview as the character. So there were two truck drivers. One truck driver. His name was Axel Armbruster. And then two big-time wrestlers, Alvin the Ape Gorman and Moondog Maine. And they are the funniest tapes ever. I mean, not anything I did. I was just the interviewer. He was hilarious. And we, all of us, the grandkids and all of us, just are in tears every time we listen to those things. It was really funny. We did a third one, but we lost it. And like about a month ago, he was still rooting around everything, trying to look for this one tape that was missing. That was where he played an Arab oil sheikh. It was pretty funny. He had some good quotes in that too. As an athlete, he was very aware of his physical body and his physical condition. And even before he was diagnosed with Parkinson's, I think he knew something was up. Because it was about that same time when he started writing poetry, and he started making sure that everybody in his life knew exactly how he felt about them and what impact he had on them. He wrote poems for all of us, for my other brother, Dick, who was our next-door neighbor from the time we were 2 years old, who's like another son. He wrote poems for his players. Anytime there was a Hall of Fame induction, he'd write a poem for all of those guys. He just made sure that everybody knew how he felt about them. And, you know, it's another thing that we have, a treasure that we have, are the hundreds of poems and quotes that he wrote, and those will continue to guide us throughout our lives. His love as a father didn't stop with bloodlines. One of the miracles during the last week of his life, he was unconscious for almost all of it, but on Thursday evening, for about the next 24 hours, he woke up, he was off the ventilator, and suddenly he was able to speak again. And Karen had her time with him, and then on Friday, Brad had his time with him, and then on Friday night, I had my time with him, and my mom was there too. And he was able to speak. We were able to talk to each other, tell each other how much we loved each other, and all of those things. We were able to show Brad's nieces and nephews who live in Mongolia. They made a really nice tape for him. We were able to show him that. Brett organized something where all of these players put together videos. At that point, they were telling him to get well and encouraging him. But they were so inspirational for him. And Brad showed him a bunch, and I showed him a bunch. And after every one of those, he said, "That's wonderful. Tell him I'm proud of him, and tell him I love him." So he cared about each one of his players and students just like they were family. Psalm 328 says, "I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will counsel you with my eye upon you." And as I was beginning, as I said in the beginning, I could go on with this forever, but I'm going to finish with his poem called, here we go, A Father's Love. A father's love has no boundaries or lines. Like the brightest star, it always shines. Unconditional love, as solid as stone. With a father's love, you're never alone. Harsh and disciplined, the exterior may show, but a love so soft and as pure as snow. Old rough hands and a weathered face, but a father's love has style and grace. During life's journey, when crossroads appear, a father's love can help and steer. Even in silence, that love can talk. Though distance may separate, together we walk. Between father and child, a bond so strong, honor and trust will always belong. When lonely and tired and feeling blue, a father's love is there for you. And I know that not just for Karen and Brad and me and my mom, my dad's love is with everybody and always will be. Thanks.
So unlike my own father, I actually wasn't able to write anything down. I kind of knew what I wanted to say, but can be really hard to put that all on paper. So I will try to make this brief and not too rambly. I think anyone who was lucky enough to know my grandfather knows that he had a real, seemingly never-ending well of love in his heart for everybody, and really cared about all of us, you know, about especially all the grandchildren, which is, you know, how I was related to him. I'm so sorry. All of us grandchildren. You know, he really cared about all of our interests. You know, I do acting, I do writing, and he would always, every time I was over, he'd be like, Mark, are you doing another play, Mark? And I'd recently be like, no, I can't because of the COVID stuff. And he always, even in these last months, whenever I'd be over, wanted to come up and see me, and I live 3 hours away, and he was not in the best health, and he just really found everybody. I'm so sorry. I just want to read a poem of his, because obviously my own words on the man are failing me, and I think his words will illustrate my point a lot better. This poem is called Find That Diamond. A diamond is found deep in the earth. It is cut and polished and measured for worth. Great value, it has a treasured jewel adorned by kings and others who rule. A symbol of wealth, it is held in esteem. A diamond is precious and answers a dream. Well, inside of each person is a diamond so rare, it just needs to be polished and treated with care. Go find your diamond, let its carats shine, its value will grow like the finest of wine. And I think that really illustrates how, you know, he obviously found his own diamond in the baseball diamond, and he wanted everyone else in his life and just everybody to find that same, to find something they were passionate about and find something they were really special at and to really succeed at it. And he really encouraged that in everybody. And, you know, like my dad said, you know, it didn't have to be baseball. It could be, you know, anything that you were passionate about, he would see that and really encourage you to go after that. So that was my granddad. Thanks.
Next up is Brandon.
Yeah, like Mark, baseball wasn't ever my passion. But that didn't matter when you were talking with my granddad, because inevitably when you spoke with him, the conversation always steered back towards what you were passionate about. And we had a similar point of interest, which was storytelling. And as many of you know, my granddad was a phenomenal storyteller. Whenever he would tell a story, I'd be reminded of a certain character in a John Steinbeck novel.
Well, keep talking. It's just the Prietos and the Roland share a common challenge.
Yeah, vertical challenge.
There we go.
Thanks. Thank you. So he reminded me of a character out of a Steinbeck book, but not probably the one you're thinking of, not Grapes of Wrath. I was reminded of a character out of East of Eden who was a blacksmith. And this blacksmith was a charismatic man, great sense of humor, and people would come from all over the Salinas Valley just to hear him hold court. And Steinbeck describes these farmers in this area that they would gather in the blacksmith's shop and they would drink in these stories like water. They would be renewed and revitalized. He would lift them above their everyday experience and take them somewhere special. And these men, these thirsty people would gather up these stories like water in their hands, and they would desperately try to take this water home to their families. But inevitably, by the time they got home, they found that the stories had run through their fingers. It was the events were jumbled, and those details that were so vivid and fresh became fuzzy. And the punchline, whenever they got to it, would be met with crickets. And they'd say, I guess he had to be there. You know, he tells it better. The thing about my granddad is, when he told the story, you didn't have to be there. You felt like you were there. He became the characters that he was describing. He had an ear for language. He could capture the way people spoke. And he was, he could just capture the essence of people. The first time I think the source of his talent as a coach and the source of his talent as a storyteller all come from the same source, and that's the fact that he was an incredible listener. He really listened to people. I remember the first time that my granddad met my father-in-law and my brother-in-law. I didn't really prep them for the situation that was about to happen. I didn't tell them about who he was. They didn't know about his accomplishments. They didn't know his reputation. They just knew that he was my granddad. So I did that because I like to see my granddad operate out in the wild. He had the same effect on every person when they were in front of him. They would tune in, calm down, and inevitably they would light up. So after, and I saw that play out, you know. And after that night was over, my father-in-law, my brother-in-law came up to me and was like, what? Who is this person? He's not a normal person, right? He's like, that's a special person. I was like, yeah, I think so. Yeah. But the thing about it was, I recognized the feeling that they had. I had seen it, and I'm sure that you all recognize it too. He made you feel like, when you were in a conversation with him, he made you feel like you were the center of the universe. That for those moments that you were with him, the sun was only shining on you. He made you feel that you were the most interesting and important person in the world. And the secret was, he believed it. You were the most interesting person in the world to him when he was talking to you. It's just the way he was wired somehow. It was important, it was urgent for him to know you, to know how you worked, to know your hopes, your dreams, your fears, your aspirations. He needed to know all of it, because that was the only way he would know how to get the best out of you. If my granddad had a talent, and he had many, I think his talent was for belief, for believing in people and making them believe in themselves. You walked away from a conversation with him feeling renewed, inspired, and motivated. And I have a poem that I'd like to share with you, I think that he wrote, that I think speaks to that. His capacity to do so, to inspire. It's called Climb. Reach for the stars. Dream big dreams. Widen your horizons and fish in big streams. Search for tall mountains to conquer and climb. Let only your interest measure the time. Seek out a redwood for beauty and size. Don't measure success by the number of tries. Let space be the meter for the ideas you conceive. Let the sky be the limit for what you achieve. Climb the stairway to heaven's gate. Begin the journey now. It must not wait. And thinking about my granddad, I'm struck by how much love he put out in the world. And I just want to take this opportunity to express my immense gratitude to everyone here. Just like my Uncle Todd talked about, on his last day, he got to see and feel that love he put out in the world come back to him. I like to think that my granddad, his agenda, his goal, wasn't just to make great baseball players. He was trying to make great human beings. And I think those videos, as he watched them, as he heard your words of encouragement, of renewal, of inspiration, I think he saw his dreams come true. Each and every one of you are the fruition of his dream. We all are. We're going to carry him with us forever in every interaction that we have. His legacy, his influence is not bound by time. It'll ripple across generations. That's a legacy that's worth celebrating. So I'd like to celebrate my granddad today, and I'd like to celebrate my granny Jane today, because it is unfathomable that my granddad could be the man he was, be half the man he was, without my granny. I love you. And I thank you. Thank you.
We have some pretty good storytellers in the group, so I'm not up to that level, but I just want to say a few words today. Obviously, Granddad had an amazing way to motivate people. He could talk to you for a few minutes, listen, and then identify how and what motivates you. My freshman year at Fresno State, I was struggling a little bit, so he pulls me into his office. You ever played for him? He had that huge brown desk. You know, you sit up there, pulls you in. Hey, you know, what's wrong? Why are you struggling? So he listened to me for a few minutes and he just said, the cream always rises to the top. So I hope to make you proud today, Granddad. Rise to the occasion today and every day I have on this earth. This encouragement of yours has motivated me to achieve success in every aspect of my life. Many of us hope to leave just a ripple effect here on this earth. Granddad's impact was a tidal wave. His impact on our family, our community, and the baseball world is immeasurable. Everyone in this room knows that. I want to tell you a little bit about Granddad the way I know him. And many of you in this room will share the same sentiment, I'm sure. We all have stories about him, stories that will make us laugh, stories that will make us cry, taught us life lessons, and will guide us throughout our lives. And I want to share just a couple. Sorry, the sniffling's a little loud in there. Recurring theme, stories about fundamentals. Probably earliest memories, 3, 4, 5 years old, going to Granny and Granddad's house on Flora Street. Come in. All right, Jordy, show me the pitching mechanics. Go in, weight back, foot, pressure, all these things, right? We just go through the whole thing. Plant foot. When do you break your hands? I mean, and I'm 4. Like, do I need this? And it wasn't, you know, that's how it was. It was just boom, boom, boom. And, oh, yeah, your weight, you landed a little on the outside of that front foot. You know, toe in. So you can see his face, you know, and he's just doing it. And so the lesson was not just that work ethic, but attention to every detail. Attention to what part of your body tells you. Results come from hard work and attention to all of those details. Execution of every detail is critical in the process of achieving success. I take that skill into every lesson into every aspect of my work and my businesses. And to him, I'm thankful for that life lesson. He exemplified importance of time together. You hear that as a recurring theme throughout this, you know, whether it's trying to get up to see Mark do his plays, helping Jeff out, talking with Brett doing the woodworking, you know, just whatever it may be. For him and I, we used to golf together at Copper River, and we would smoke cigars right after his retirement, 2-3 days a week, 2.5 hours. Well, you know, he doesn't do anything slow. So that round was 2.5 hours, and it was as quick as you could go. Just hit go. So it was quick. But, you know, 2.5-3 hours of good time together, and all those memories can never be taken away. He was there for a lot of important milestones. My white coat ceremony at USC, my graduation from dental school, our wedding in Virginia. He and Granny would always go an extra mile to be with us and be by our sides, and that kind of speaks to what we all know.
Jordan, all your family that has time to get that off.
What is it, a hanger? Thank you. I appreciate it. Just throw it away. Before I left for residency, my granny had shared her love for a place called Preservation Hall. So if any of you have ever been to New Orleans, it's a really famous jazz hall there, special place. And she shared that her and Granddad had gone there on their trips, probably to Tulane or LSU. And so every time I go back, we go back, and obviously it's an important city to me. I met my wife there. And we have a daughter named Nola because of that city. But we go back, and I always request one song. They do song by request at Preservation Hall. So if you ever go, give them $20. They'll play Saints or All Saints or whatever. And I always request Louis Armstrong's Wonderful World. And I think of Granny and Granddad. And there's one verse in particular. I hear babies cry. I watch them grow. They'll learn much more than I'll never know. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. It really is a wonderful world, and he and Granny helped make it so for their children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren. Their love and guidance they gave to their children, which in turn helped guide us so that we could grow and learn more than they could ever dream of. I'm going to finish up with a few things that I'll miss the most. Him sitting at the head of a table with a full glass full to the brim of ice, a Diet Coke or Diet Soda at family lunch on Sundays or all the holidays. His hands. He had a firm handshake until the end. He taught me every grip of a baseball with those hands. He wrote many encouraging words and powerful poems with those hands. He made furniture that I have in my backyard to remember him by with those hands. They showed years of hard work. They showed years of living his passions. Those hands helped many, and they lifted us up in times of need. His laugh, his encouragement, and his storytelling. Lastly, I just want to say I love you, Granddad. You are missed dearly. Sometimes God's lessons are not learned through blessings or gains, but in a loss. And I've learned a lot in this loss because that's what he would want.
Brandon, you and Jordan have shattered a Prieto myth today. Everybody always thinks you're just badass boys, all right? You've shown heart and love and compassion. And dang, Brandon, you might be a preacher someday, all right? You got a gift. You've got your granddad's gift of telling stories. You've heard from the guys. Now you're going to get to hear from the pretty members of the family, all right? Natalie, come on up and share your thoughts. And you're going to be followed by Hannah, all right?
I don't get to do this very often.
Oh, yeah. Thank you. All right. Well, there's so many memories and things that I would love to share right now, but I wanted to talk about what has been constantly coming back into my mind recently, just thinking about Granddad, and that is honestly the simple conversations around the dining table. And Jordan kind of illustrated it lovely in a really lovely way, and the fact that Granddad would sit there at the table with his diet soda, and you could just sense this interest in what you had to say. You could just see him light up when you sat down with him at the table. You'd see, you know, the light in his eyes and the smile that he would have when we would start talking about things that were really important to us. That was my most favorite, and is my most favorite experience of Granddad, and it's truly been about how he spent time with people, how he spent time with me, the way that he did that. And I also just, I have an image in my head, and I just keep getting brought back to it of him sitting there and just kind of getting repositioned in the chair, you know, ready to get a good stance for talking about things that were important. Granddad was the epitome of teacher, coach, friend, father, grandfather, so much more. He taught me through the way he lived his life. how to hold my own virtues and values with great esteem. And it is because of Granddad that I know the value of integrity, perseverance, dedication, honor. It is also because of Granddad that I've learned how to have passion and respect for people and the things that I believe in. I remember one day as an adolescent, I was struggling with some thoughts, negative, of course, trying time, adolescence. And as others have shared, he went into his collection of books and brought me out The Power of Positive Thinking, and he talked to me about how valuable it had been to him. And it was through the combination of his positive thinking and trust in God that I soon began to discover for myself the meaning and value of hope. I'm truly blessed and thankful God gave me Granddad. He is and always will be the foundation of our family. Since a child, I've known his unconditional love, and it was always there, always, unquestioning, unwavering, and simple. Life has seemed so complicated at times, but Granddad always seemed to have an understanding that simplified the storm and ultimately calmed it. As I reflected on my time with him, I realized I learned by watching him, just simply watching, listening, and sitting with him, just his presence. What I took away from studying him was that he was a balanced man, and there was something so deeply special in that. I watched him find balance in all that he did, from his role as coach on and off the field to his role in our family. He was a leader and knew when to let others lead. He was brave and also aware of his emotions. He was kind and knew when to be stern. He was intelligent and always looking to learn. He was confident and yet humble, hopeful, while also unafraid to share his concerns. He was willing to change, and also he understood when he needed to stand firm. He was believing and questioning, funny and deep thinking. His passion for what he loved, his family, friends, and baseball always translated to me into the fundamentals for understanding my own purpose. So many of his words were based for with regards to baseball were just metaphors for the greater game of life. Granddad helped me understand my calling as he did for so many others. My career today, my marriage, my motherhood, my role as daughter, sister, and friend, they're all firmly rooted in the lessons he taught me. And I hope to reflect back into the world the things that he's shown me so that his legacy lives on through the lives of those I encounter. Granddad was so wise beyond his years. And though I only knew him for 34 of those years, I imagine that that wisdom was there way longer before me and touched so many other lives that we don't even know about. He once wrote me a letter 16 years ago when I was going through tough times, and I thought I'd share with you some of his words that I believe he would say to any of us now. He wrote, "In your search to find your role in life, you will face the good and the bad, the ups and the downs, and travel the rocky terrain that most must endure in order to find success, fulfillment, and happiness. Never be afraid or reluctant to share your success and memorable moments. Never ignore those who are sincerely willing to lend a helping hand. And when you occasionally feel alone or lost, remember that God is always with you, and so are those who love you." And I know Granddad's here with us today, and I know that he loved us all. Thank you.
So this is a really tough act to follow. Everybody just had so many beautiful things to say. First, I want to say thank you to everybody that sent videos to my granddad while he was in the hospital. Excuse me. They're all so beautiful, and I know that they meant so much to him. I haven't seen them all, but the ones I have seen have been such a huge gift to me. We're all here because of the impression Granddad made on our hearts and in our lives. After reading through his poetry and looking through boxes of pictures, it's clear He loved his life, and he felt so blessed by the relationships he had with all of us. He wrote a poem titled Blessed, and the last paragraph reads, "Then he said, how fortunate am I to be so blessed that I could cry." He was a beautiful poet and expressed his love, ambitions, and wisdom through poetry. So today I would like to share a poem that I wrote for him, titled My Granddad. Some knew him as Coach, others as Bob Bennett, but as my granddad, he was much different. He was the old guy jogging uphill in Thailand's 100 degree heat and humidity. No music, no sunscreen, no water, just determination and positivity. He has taught many a good baseball swing, but taught me my mindset can overcome anything. He taught me dedication by busting out hundreds of nightly crunches and how to stay gracious even when life throws punches. My granddad was a beautiful poet. He was wise, thoughtful, and loved deeply. With very few words, he'd let you know it, using profound rhymes ever so sweetly. Baseball, scratchers, cigars, diet soda are just a few things that make him happy, but nothing compared to the love he had for his friends, family, and my granny. He dedicated his life to others, helping anyone he met succeed. I hope to represent his legacy by living life beautifully at full speed. As a little girl, I would cringe at the thought of one of your big wet kisses. To experience one more is just one of my many wishes. I'm gonna do it. It was whether or not I was gonna say this last one or not, I think you guys would understand, and I mean no disrespect. So until we meet again, memories are what I carry, for I know you're in a better place where your toenails are no longer scary. Thank you, guys.
Hannah, you don't have to take a back seat to any of them, all right? You did a great job. I tell you, I now have one big disappointment, though. I did not know. You never told me, guys, that your granddad loved cigars. I have missed that experience of enjoying a cigar. Okay, so Bob, you got to come have one with me now. Let's sit back and watch the pictorial tribute that the family has put together. Sit back and enjoy.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was so lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. Through many dangers, toils and snares, I have already come. 'Tis grace hath brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, to sing God's praise than when we first begun. No, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first
Bennett has not been there 10,000 days yet, but he will be, and that means you and I have the privilege and the opportunity of one day being with him again. You have a chance of hearing that voice and seeing that smirk that makes you wonder what he's about to say next. If there was ever a man that I had the opportunity of meeting in my life that I thought could have made heaven out of human effort, it might have been Bob Bennett. The way in which he treated his family, the way in which he treated his friends, his players, the way he lived his life. If there was ever a way to earn heaven, Bob might have been one of the rare to have done it. But the song you just heard about is an insight of great hope that you talked about, that it's not based upon our ability to earn or to buy or to connive. But heaven is a gift that's offered to all of us, not forced on any of us, but a free gift offered to all of us, not because we deserve it, but simply because God loves us. It's a privilege for us to say yes to the love of Bob Bennett in our life. It is even a greater privilege to say yes to the love of Christ in our life. And that's the difference of walking away from here with greater despair or with greater hope. You mentioned, Todd, that Bob had some naysayers during his career. There were times he had to put up with some struggles, criticism, frustrations. UCLA alumni and fans, I know that's, you got connections there. But UCLA football coach Pepper Rogers' life was made miserable by some of his fans. It was during a season when the Bruins got off to a horrible start. Nobody in Southern California would hang out with them. Coach Rogers said, "My dog's my only true friend." He said, "I told my wife that in every man's life, you need at least two good friends. My wife bought me a second dog." Rogers could be rigid in the face of adversity. When his players at UCLA were having difficulty adapting to the wishbone, he installed, the school's alumni demanded he adopt another system. Rogers wouldn't budge. The wishbone, he said, is like faith in Jesus Christ. If you believe in it only when something goes wrong, you didn't believe in it in the first place. When things go wrong is when we must believe in what we trust. That makes all the difference in the world. My favorite baseball story is a story of a boy about 7 or 8 years old walking through the house carrying a bat in his hand and flipping a ball up in the other hand. And as he's walking through the house, he's saying with great confidence, "I am the greatest hitter in the world." His mom hears him from the kitchen and she watches him head out to the backyard. He tosses the ball up in the air and he takes a mighty swing and he misses it. And he says, "Strike one. I am still the greatest hitter in the world." I think he read the power of positive thinking. He tossed the ball up a second time, took a bigger cut, missed it again. "Strike two. I am still the greatest hitter in the world." For the third time, he tosses the ball in the air, takes a mighty cut, misses it even more than he did the first two times. "Strike three. I am the greatest pitcher in the world." I love that young man's attitude. It's an attitude that Bob permeated throughout his life and his career. It is one that will make a difference for us if we understand a biblical principle where Paul wrote, God said, "I will take the all things in your life and I will use them for good. The good, the bad, and the ugly." It's not just the pleasant things. It's not just the nice things. But God says, "I'll take the all things of life, and if you'll trust me, I will use them for good in your life." Two verses, a couple of comments, and we'll wrap up today. The wisest man who ever lived wrote in the book of Proverbs, chapter 16, verse 9, these words, "In his heart, a man plans his steps, but the Lord determines his ways." Bob could plan his steps up to a certain moment in life, and then he can't plan anymore. And God says, "I'll devise a plan where life will go on." Psalm 37:4 was written by the wisest man's father. Solomon wrote Proverbs. David wrote this passage in Psalms. "Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart." I don't know what you believe about unusual moments that you can't explain. You were thinking about somebody and 2 days later you bump into them. You hadn't seen them in months or years. You're struggling with something and all of a sudden the answer just plops right in front of you. Coincidence, luck, chance. May I suggest you an alternative today? And it could be an alternative that's facing you today. It could be a God wink moment. Do you remember your dad teaching you guys how to wink? I remember my dad doing it, and I couldn't do it very well, and so I would do this. And then I eventually got to where I could do one eye at the time. I thought about a God wink about 4 years ago. I was preparing for a memorial service very early on a Thursday morning, about 5:30, 6 o'clock. I was in the office, and I was working on a service for the next day, and I was in shorts and a T-shirt and tennis shoes, ball cap. And about an hour after I was sitting there, I get a phone call from Fort Washington Country Club. For 3 or 4 years, they have invited me to their senior tournament, to their flagpole event, to share just a devotional thought, encouragement of the day, and to start this tournament off. And they had asked me months before if I would do it again this year, and I said, sure, and I wrote it on something, but I didn't put it in my phone. I was to be there in 35 minutes. I had nothing prepared to say that morning, nothing. I jump in my car and I run home and I shout at my wife and I say, "I got to get in the, did I tell you I was in shorts and a T-shirt and a ball cap? I'm going to a country club. I needed to get better." So I jump in a shower, I yell at my wife and I tell her to lay something out. And so I jump in it and on the way there, I breathe a little prayer. Oh, and by the way, I must confess. When the guy said, "Hey, Tim, just checking, you are going to be here this morning, right?" Because he called me at the office, and I was usually really early, and I've only had about 45 minutes now. And I said, "Oh, yeah," I said, "I'm on my way." I lied. It's not good for pastors to lie, but I at that moment I did. And I jumped in my car, and on the way there I prayed. Number one, "Lord, I'm sorry I lied." And number two, "God, I need to be bailed out. I need something." And at that moment, I looked down in the car seats at a book I had stuck there from Sunday. A lady at church said, "Tim, have you ever read this book?" And she hands it to me, and it's called When God Winks at You. I said, "Never seen the book, never heard of it." And it's and I still hadn't read it. But all I saw was the title. And as I'm driving, I'm thinking, "God winks. God, I need a big wink right now." And all of a sudden, I thought, when did I learn to wink? Why do I wink? When did I teach my boys to wink? And I was thinking all of those things. I started to think, you know what? The reason we wink at each other is to get attention. It's to let somebody know that we're thinking about them. I used to wink at Chad when he'd go up to bat. Just let him know, "Hey, I'm for." If he got a hit, I'd wink at him at first base. If he struck out, I'd wink at him in the dugout. "Hey, it's okay. I'm with you." We also wink to let somebody else know that we are interested in them. And we want to see if they wink back to encourage us to take the next step. We wink with the hope of a good result. Have you ever noticed God wink at you? Those little circumstances with no explanations, those coincidences that are crazy, the crossing of paths at just the right moment. God never forces his way into your life. He simply winks at you and says, "I'm here. Are you interested?" As I finished the drive to the golf course that day, I reflected back about God wink moments in my own life, and I realized there was one I wasn't even aware of. It happened before I was born. My dad was in World War II, and he was shot up in a battle and had shrapnel in his back, and he was told he would never make it back to the States alive. It was a God wink moment. If he hadn't survived, I wouldn't be here today. In those days when Chad and Jordan were at Dry Creek, I was asked to serve on a cross-cultural committee. And I went to this meeting with another dad from Dry Creek who was Hispanic. And he and I went to this cross-cultural meeting. And it was late starting. And it's because the leader wasn't there. And this really big guy, about 6'6", very dark complected, comes walking in and says, "I'm sorry, I'm late." And the dad who was with me poked me and said, "Tim, that is the biggest Mexican I have ever seen." And I said, "You know, I think this is one time that you might have misjudged who that is." I said, I think he is an American Indian. He's either Choctaw or Cherokee." Guy gets up front and he introduces himself and he said, "I'm a full-blooded Choctaw from Oklahoma. Well, I have a card in my wallet that says I'm 1/32nd Choctaw Indian. My grandfather was a Choctaw Indian from there." And after that meeting was over, I walked up to the gentleman. I stuck out my hand and I introduced myself. Small part of the backstory. About 2 weeks before that, I'd become very discouraged in ministry and I was about ready to quit. I didn't know if this is what I should do for the rest of my life. And I walked up and I introduced myself to this gentleman and I said, I showed him my card. I said, "I'm 1/32nd Choctaw." And I said, "We might be related." And he laughed and he said, "What are you doing?" I said, "I'm a pastor." He said, "You know, I remember the first preacher I ever met. I was 10 years old. It was on the reservation in Oklahoma. And there was this preacher who would come about every 3 months and he would preach a service on either a Saturday or a Sunday night. And when I was 10 years old, I walked forward and I gave my life to Jesus Christ and it changed my future completely. I was headed for prison with the kind of life I wanted to live. And my life was changed and I've been different ever since. I've never seen that preacher since, but I'll never forget his name. His name was George McLean. If you look at my driver's license, my full name is Timothy McLean Roland. And George McLean was my grandfather. It was a God wink moment that said, "Tim, you may feel frustrated, but you're right where I want you to be." God winks at us. Oh, by the way, the funeral I was preparing for that Thursday morning that I was almost late to get to the golf course to speak at, his name was Wayne Morgan. And I met him 2 years before at that golf tournament, at that flagpole. And when he went home that day, he said, "When I die, get that guy." God wink moments. God may be giving you one right now. I'm not asking you to become religious. Bob was certainly not a religious guy. He was a believer. There's a difference between religion and believing. There's a lot of religious folks who will never see the gate of heaven because all they knew was a system of right and wrong, never a relationship with Jesus Christ. You sat at a dinner table with your grandfather. You stood in a backyard getting tips with your grand. It was a relationship. It wasn't because you were born into his family. It was because because of that, he had a relationship with you. He could have easily ignored you. Today, God's given you a God wink moment, not to become a Baptist or a Presbyterian or a Methodist, but have an opportunity to invite Jesus Christ into your life. Have a personal relationship with him. We often make this too complicated. That's what religion does. It takes something simple and it makes it difficult. Here's the fundamentals. Believe that Jesus is who he said he was. It's why we celebrate Christmas. He lived, he died, and he rose again from the dead. That's why we celebrate Easter. Do you understand? If it wasn't for Easter, we never, ever would celebrate Christmas. Because the birth of Jesus without the resurrection was just the birth of another Jewish boy in Bethlehem. What makes it special is he lived, and he died, and he rose again. And that's why this place is not all there is. There's something more. Two thieves hung on a cross, one on each side of Jesus. One of them, at the last breath he had, cursed Christ and died. The other one said to his friend or brother on the other side of Jesus, "Shut up! You and I are getting what we deserve." And then he looked at Jesus, and here was his prayer. See, it's not religious. It's not complicated. He looked at Jesus and said, "You don't deserve this. I do. Remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus said to him at that moment, "Today, you will be with me." Not fancy, not religion. Didn't have time to go to church, didn't have time to do a good deed, didn't have time to give one offering. All he had time to do was admit he had a need and respond to the one who can meet that need. Don't make this difficult. There was a doctor who went to a party one night, and he saw one of his patients out on the dance floor with a very beautiful woman cutting a rug. And the doctor runs up to his patient and says, "What are you doing out here? You could die." And the patient says, "Doc, I'm following your advice." And the doctor said, "What advice did I give you that said you could be out here doing this?" He said, "Doc, I believed you told me, find a hot mama and be cheerful." And the doctor said, "That is not what I said. I said you have a heart murmur. Be careful." We sometimes confuse the simplest things. Don't confuse a relationship with Jesus Christ. There's a book written called In Light of Eternity. And the author imagines two twins having a conversation in the womb of their mother. One says, "You know, there's a whole world out there, grassy meadows, snowy mountains, splashing streams, waterfalls, baseball games, horses, dogs, cats, skyscrapers, cities, people like us, only much bigger, playing games that we would love to participate in." "Are you crazy?" the other twin responds. "That's just wishful thinking. Everybody knows there's no life after birth. And there's a lot of people who want to believe there's no life after death." Bob would love to tell us today, "Don't you believe them? I am more alive than I have ever been before." Simply choose to believe in Jesus Christ. If you've chosen to believe that, as Bob did, then you'll have the thrill of knowing the reality of what Bob Berthold is going to close our service, that the family has requested that we end this service with this song, "I Can Only Imagine." I don't know about you, but I've got a pretty wild imagination. And heaven will be far more grand than you and I could ever, ever anticipate. It is not billowy clouds and playing of harps. God says, whatever your wild imagination is, heaven will be better than that. Let's listen.
I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Yeah. I'll be surrounded by your glory. What will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Oh, and all of you be still. Will I stand in your presence? Or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I will do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine. I'll be surrounded by your glory. What will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Oh, and all of you be still. Will I stand in your presence? Or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. Oh, surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? To my knees will I fall? Will I sing a hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. Oh, I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. I can only imagine when all I will do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine.
If you've never taken the opportunity to personally invite Christ to come live in your life, you can use your own words at this moment. This would be a wonderful God wink moment, and it would honor Bob's legacy even more. Let's pray. Our Father, every one of us in this room is so grateful that at some point in our life, and for some, a long period of time, we had the opportunity to let Bob Bennett influence our life. Whether it was brief or whether it was extended, the privilege of getting to know him is one that we will never forget, and one we express deep gratitude. Father, I commit to you the needs of a wife who walked with him for 65 years. May she find encouragement and hope in,
in knowing how much Bob has loved her and how he's excited to see her again. I pray for his daughter and his sons, their spouses and their grandkids. May they walk away from here encouraged by the legacy, the memories, and the valuable lessons that their granddad, their dad, has taught them. Father, thank you for the sweetness of this day as we've listened to family members pay tribute to one who meant so much to them. And thank you most for your care, for your comfort, and for your offer of grace. May we willingly accept it today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I want to let you know that the family hopes to plan a very special event later in the year when things have loosened up, and maybe even we could do it at the baseball field that has his name on it. And so many of you could come out and you could share your thoughts and your stories. So stay tuned to that, because we'll get that information out in every possible way that we can. And we look forward to doing that as well. At this time, we're so grateful also for Boyce Funeral Home and the services that they've provided for the Bennett family. We're going to ask their staff to come, and they're going to lead the family out into the pavilion. And then they're going to come and dismiss you row by row, and you may either go out the side doors and greet the family out there, or you may go out the doors in which you entered and go around and greet the family, whichever is most convenient for you. So Mark's going to come open these side doors, and if, gentlemen, would you would come down and lead the family out, that would be terrific. May I make you also aware, in case you need it, there are restrooms in the back of this building. Men's on my right, ladies on my left. There's also restrooms that are open just across the pavilion. Family, if you would stand here on the front two rows.